So glad that each of you are here this evening. Alicia, that's at Andrews Institute, not the Gulf Breeze Hospital. The Andrews Institute in Gulf Breeze is what it is. So, but be remembering her and her surgery. Also, received word today of a couple of deaths in relationship to some preachers that we know. Brother John West, who spoke on our lectureship this year, his father passed away this afternoon from a stroke. So be remembering that family. Then Brother Danny Douglas, that I'm sure all of you remember from both our lectureship and I think last year he held our gospel meeting. His mother passed away this afternoon as well. So be remembering both of these families as they go through this time of sorrow in their life. The Bible gives us a lot of examples that we are to learn from. Of course, the Old Testament, that's one of the reasons that we have the Old Testament. It gives us accounts of action that we can learn from those accounts of action. New Testament also gives us many accounts of action or examples that some of them good, some of them bad. And we can learn from each one. We can learn from the good ones as to how we are to do and how we are to live, what we are to do, the attitudes that we are to have. But we can also learn a great deal from those that were bad examples for us. And this evening, and probably some subsequent lessons, I want us to look at one bad example in particular. And that is Peter's denial. In the song that we just sang, I believe it was the fourth verse, "Will you deny him like Peter did?" In relationship to our Lord. Well, that's a negative example for us. Because as we remember back, Peter denied our Lord three times. And there was a continuing intensity with each denial. I thought it was interesting that all four accounts of the life of Christ record the denial of Peter. Matthew 26, verses 69 through 75. Mark 14, verses 66 through 72. Luke 22, verses 54 through verse 62. And then John the 18th chapter in verses 15 through 27. I want us to read together Matthew's account. In other lessons, we'll read some of the others, but we'll start with Matthew's account this evening. Matthew, the 26th chapter, verse 69 through 75. It says that now Peter sat without in the palace, and a damsel came unto him, saying, "Thou also was with Jesus of Galilee." But he denied before them all, saying, "I know not what thou sayest." And when he was gone out into the porch, another maid saw him, and said unto them that were there, "This fellow was also with Jesus of Nazareth." And he again denied it with an oath, "I do not know the man." And after a while came unto him they that stood by, and said to Peter, "Surely thou also art one of them, for thy speech betrayeth thee. Then began he to curse and to swear, saying, "I know not the man." And immediately the cock crew, and Peter remembered the words of Jesus, which said unto him, "Before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice." And he went out and wept bitterly. Certainly this is a very negative example for us. It's not one that we should follow, but we should learn from it. But there is, as we look at this situation that Peter was in, an increasing intensity in relationship to his denials. When the first occasion comes up, they're simply, "I know not what you're talking about. I know not what thou sayest." A simple denial. Then another maid sees him, says, "Sure, you were one of them." And this time it says he denied it with an oath. In one of the lexicons, it's actually Bagster's Danker, Art, and Gingrich. They define this word oath as meaning guarantee by means of an oath. Thus, he is making a guarantee by use of an oath that he does not know him. Later on, they come to him and tell him, "Surely you are one of his disciples because of the way that you talk. Your speech betrays you." And so it says this time he began to deny it with a curse and with an oath. He began to curse and to swear, saying, "I know not the man." A lot of times when we read this, we do Peter an injustice. Because we read that he began to curse and to swear, and all of a sudden our minds jump to that Peter used profanity. That's the way we use the idea of cursing and swearing, is someone using profanity. That's not what these words mean here. Again, using a couple of lexicons, the word curse here is, according to Lowe and Nida, to invoke divine harm if what is said is not true. Again, using the definition of Bagster, Danker, Arndt, and Gingrich, in relationship to the word swear, they say, to affirm the veracity of one's statement by invoking a transcendent entity. And I'll throw in the idea, by transcendent entity, they're meaning God. Or it could be, if it was being used by a heathen, by an idol, a transcendent being. And then they go on to say, frequently with implied invitation of punishment if one is untruthful. Have you ever heard anyone say, "I'm telling the truth, and if I'm not, may God strike me dead"? That's the idea of cursing and swearing here. It is invoking divine harm. May God strike me dead, in that illustration. Or, I promise, I swear by God, affirming it with an oath, but also with an implied invitation of punishment, using the definition of that's found there regarding the word swear. I swear this is true, but if I'm not telling the truth, then a woe upon me. That's the idea of cursing and swearing here. It's not using the Lord's name in vain. It's not what we would refer to as profanity. It is that invoking God's harm upon oneself if what he says is not true. And so he's saying, basically, God place a wall upon me if what I'm saying is not true, that I do not know the man. And so you see an increasing intensity in relationship to Peter's denial. And when we think about Peter, we need to realize who this is that's denying Jesus. Because from the very beginning of Jesus' ministry, Peter was there the entirety of time. In Matthew, the 4th chapter, verses 17 and through verse 20, it says that from that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter, and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And he said unto them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." And they straightway left their nets and followed him. This is at the very beginning of Jesus' ministry, when he began to preach and to say, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And from that very beginning of his ministry, he calls Peter, and Peter becomes a follower of Jesus from that time forward. And so he had been with Jesus all of this time during Jesus' public ministry. When you turn over a few chapters to Matthew, the 8th chapter, we find that Peter's wife's mother, his mother-in-law, was sick of a fever. It says in Matthew 8, verses 14 and 15, "And when Jesus was come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother laid and sick of a fever. And he touched her, and the fever left her, and she arose and ministered unto them." And thus here you have, from a family situation, Jesus healing his mother-in-law, so that now then his mother-in-law is immediately healed, rises up off of the bed, and begins ministering unto the people. And thus, from his own personal family, Jesus has performed this miracle to help and to aid in relationship to his own family. Turn over a few chapters later, Matthew, the 14th chapter. And here, there has been a multitude that Jesus has been teaching. And after teaching them and feeding them, it says, starting in verse 22 of Matthew 14, "And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side, while he sent the multitude away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into the mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship," this is a ship now that the apostles are on, including Peter, "the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with the waves, for the waves were was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, 'It is a spirit,' and they cried out for fear. And straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, 'Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid.' And Peter answered him and said, 'Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water.' And he said, 'Come.' And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried, saying, 'Lord, save me.' And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, 'O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?' And when they were come into the ship, the wind ceased. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, 'Of a truth, that thou art the Son of God.'" Consider that event in Peter's life and the impression that that must have made on his life. That here he is, and he is a fisherman. by trade, one who would go out on the sea on a regular basis. And yet, now then they see someone walking on the water and they're afraid. Because here's the wind boisterous and they've been rowing all night or trying to get to the other side all night. And they're in the middle of the Sea of Galilee now. And all of a sudden they see this figure walking on the water. An amazing sight all by itself. And Jesus tells them, don't be afraid, be of good cheer, it's I. And Peter, as impetuous as he is, says, Lord, if it's you, bid me come unto you on the water. Go ahead, come up, come ahead. And he gets out, he steps out onto the water, and he starts walking on the water. What a marvelous event that must be in his life. And yes, we know that he started looking around and seeing all of the waves and he became fearful and he started sinking. And so he cried out, Lord, save me! And immediately the Lord saves him. Again, think of the marvel that must have caused Peter. That here he has been walking on the water. And when he starts to sink because of his doubt in seeing the wind and the waves, and he cries out to the Lord, save me, and the Lord reaches out his hand and pulls him up out of the water, saves him. Truly an awe-inspiring event, no doubt, within Peter's life. And you know, I get a little bit wondering about Jesus' statement, O thou of little faith. And yet here he is, he's said to Jesus, if it's you, let me come to you walking on the water. And he steps out and he starts walking on the water. O ye of little faith. Yes, we know the doubt that came into his mind, but just to step out onto the water, knowing that they're in the middle of the sea, how many of us would have done that? Would you be willing to? Would I be willing to? And you start seeing, yes, someone that has great faith, but their faith waned during that time of doubt when they saw the wind and the waves. And that's when he started to sink, but Jesus saves him. It's interesting, at the end of this, when they were in the ship, they came, and it says they worshiped him, saying, of a truth, thou art the Son of God. This event caused them to recognize the greatness of this one that they were with. Not that there weren't other occasions where that would be true, but this caused them to fall down and worship him. A marvelous event in the life of Peter. We go over a few more chapters in Matthew. And we come to the 17th chapter of Matthew. And as we begin that chapter, it says that after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them. And his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. And there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah, or Elias, talking with him. Then answered Peter and said unto Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us build here 3 tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. And while he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were sore afraid. And Jesus came and touched them and said, "Arise and be not afraid." And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus only. And as they were come down from the mountain, Jesus charged them, saying, "Tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead." And the disciples asked him, saying, "Why then say the scribes that Elias must first come?" And Jesus answered and said unto them, "Elias truly shall first come and restore all things. But I say unto you that Elias is come already. And they knew him not, but have done unto him whatsoever they listed. Likewise shall also the Son of Man suffer of them." And the disciples understood that he spake unto them of John the Baptist. Again, a marvelous, wondrous event in the life of Peter in relationship to Jesus. And here he is on this Mount of Transfiguration. Just he along with James and John, just the three of them. And they awake out of sleep, and here they see the great lawgiver of the Old Testament, Moses himself. And can you imagine the awe and the esteem that must be there on that occasion? Because this is Moses. He's the great lawgiver. He's the one who spoke with God face to face. And then also there is Elijah. He's the great prophet of the Old Testament. Was with the school of the prophets. Here's the two great individuals of the Old Testament, and there they are speaking with Jesus, and there's Peter, James, and John viewing all of it. And to see Jesus, his face shining as the sun, his clothing as white as the light, what an awe-inspiring event that Peter is witnessing on this occasion. And so, as Peter often does, again, his impetuousness, he makes the statement, "Let's build three tabernacles. One for you, Jesus, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." That shows the great respect that Peter held for Jesus. To put him on the same level as the great lawgiver of the Old Testament, the great prophet of the Old Testament, to put Jesus on that same level is elevating, to the Jewish mind at least, Jesus to a state that no one else would attain. That's the esteem that Peter had for Jesus. But while he's saying this, here's this bright cloud overshadows them. Can you imagine the wonder of that bright cloud overshadow them? And then they start hearing this voice out of the cloud which says, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him." That here is the great lawgiver of the Old Testament, the great prophet of the Old Testament, and here is a voice of heaven saying, "Here is my Son, the Son of God Himself," in their presence. And to no longer hear that great prophet of the Old Testament, no longer to hear that great lawgiver of the Old Testament, we're seeing what's going to come in the New Testament times, that we're no longer subject to that Old Testament law. We're no longer to hear that of the Old Testament. We're under a new lawgiver, Jesus Christ. Hear Him. What a marvelous and awe-inspiring event within Peter's life. And so you start thinking of these events within the life of Peter. And it's this individual now who is now denying his Lord. That one who he has venerated, who he has worshipped, who he has seen, I'm going to elevate him to the same level of Moses and Elijah. And yet I hear the voice saying, he's my son. He's greater than Moses. He's greater than Elijah. He is my son, and you're to hear him, and not Moses and Elijah. And within his own family, this one has done this marvelous miracle of, yes, compassion to the family of Peter in healing his mother-in-law so that she would be able to get up and start ministering to them. All of those events in the life of Peter, and now then, he is denying his Lord. And with greater intensity as it goes along, I know not the man. Then he takes an oath, I know not, I know him not. And then he begins to curse and to swear, I know not the man. Truly a mistake in the life of this great man, Peter. But it's a mistake that we need to learn from. The first thing that we can learn is that pride is dangerous. If you go back just a little bit before these denials, we read Matthew, the 26th chapter, the latter part of that, but if you go back to verse 33, Jesus has just told him, you're going to deny me. And Peter's answer and said unto him, though all men shall be offended because of thee, yet will I never be offended. These other disciples and apostles, they might be offended, but not me. Can you hear the pride in his voice and in his actions or his attitude during this time? It doesn't matter what's going to take place. It doesn't matter what's going to happen. There is absolutely no way that I will be offended because of thee. Pride. But if you think Jesus had just warned him, you're going to deny me three times. Oh no, I won't. Apparently, even though all of these events had taken place in the life of Peter, and Peter knew that, yes, he's the Son of God. We're to hear him. And now then when Jesus says, this is what's going to happen, and he denies it. It's not going to happen. He apparently didn't believe what Jesus told him. You're going to deny me three times. No, I'm not. Not me. Did he think Jesus didn't know what he was talking about? Or did he just have so much self-confidence and pride that he just simply didn't believe that what Jesus said would happen? That he is somehow above that type of temptation and succumbing to that type of temptation. I'm not going to do that. Now we don't know what was going on in Peter's mind, no doubt. But apparently, he did think himself above that type of temptation or succumbing to that temptation. But we need to realize no one is above temptation. Too often times, though, we think so highly of ourselves, just like Peter did, I will not deny you. Jesus says, you're going to deny? No, I won't. Not going to happen. Uh-uh. We're so confident, self-confident, that we forget that we can fall, that we can stumble and do things that we shouldn't do. Look back again at Peter and his life. When they come to Caesarea Philippi, and Jesus asked first his apostles, "Who do men say that I am?" Why, some say you're John the Baptist, some say that you're Elijah or one of the prophets. "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter's response, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus' response, "Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, or son of Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee," who? Peter. "I'll give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Literally, and I don't really like the way that the King James translates that, literally, it would be, "Whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall have already been bound and remains bound in heaven. Whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall have already been loosed and will continue to be loosed in heaven." That's the emphasis of the Greek tense there, that's used there. But Christ, on this occasion, has promised to Peter, "I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom. You're going to be binding and loosing what God has already bound and loosed." And again, we look at the life of Peter, and Peter is one who has left everything to follow Jesus. In Mark the 10th chapter, we see that when Peter says in verse 28, "Lo, we have left all and have followed thee." That was Peter's attitude throughout the earthly ministry of Jesus. "We've left everything to follow you, Jesus. And now then, at the end, you think I'm going to deny you? And no way. You've given me the keys of the kingdom. I've left everything to follow you. I will not deny you. Why would I?" But we also see a little bit about Satan and his nature in this. Because Satan aims high sometimes. And no one is immune from his crosshair. Remember what Paul would write in 1 Corinthians 10th chapter, verse 12? "Wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall." Couldn't we say that when Peter made that affirmation, "Though all men be offended because of thee, yet will I not be offended," or "never be offended"? Couldn't we say when Peter made that statement, "Wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth"? That's what Peter was at that time. No way that I'll do that. He thought he was to stand. Take heed lest he fall. And so, just a few hours after Jesus tells him, "You're going to deny me three times," just a few short period of time after Peter has denied, "No way will I deny thee. Every man might be offended, but there's no way that I will be." And now then, he's denying his Lord three times. "Wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall." There's pride that was involved. Pride is destructive within our life. Brother Tim did an excellent job Wednesday night dealing with the aspect of pride. a haughty spirit, a haughty attitude that God hates. Solomon would also say in Proverbs 16 and verse 18 that pride goeth before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. There you see it, a perfect illustration of that in Peter. I'll not deny you. He thinks he stands. Pride there, haughty spirit. And then three times denying his Lord. Pride before destruction. Haughty spirit before fall. Jesus would say in Matthew the 23rd chapter and in verse 12 that whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased. And he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. Wouldn't you say that when Peter is there and Jesus has just proclaimed to him, you're going to deny me three times before the cock crow. And Peter's statement, though all men be offended, yet will I never be offended. He exalts himself. All men might be offended, yes, but I'm better than all men. I'll never be offended. Exalts himself. What happens? Jesus said, shall be abased. Going to be brought down. Peter was brought down very hard in denying his Lord the three times. On the other hand, that individual who humbles himself shall be exalted, Jesus says. James would write in the 4th chapter and verse 6 of his book concerning God that he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace to the humble. That individual who lifts himself up with pride, God resists him. And the word resist there is a military term that God is taking a stance against this individual in a the same way that the military would prevent someone or stop someone. Saying, you shall not pass. That's the way God is with the proud. Pride entered into Peter's life. But you know, pride is so easy for it to enter into our life as well. That, you know, surely I wouldn't be offended because of God, or because of Christ, because of Christianity. Surely I wouldn't give in to this temptation. Surely there's no way that I could do this. That's what Peter thought. That's what Peter said. I will not be offended because of you. I'll never be offended because of you. We oftentimes say, oh no, I wouldn't do something. I wouldn't do this. But as the song we sing before the lesson, what will you do with Jesus? Will you affirm him or will you deny him? Peter denied his Lord three times, yet he had affirmed without equivocation, I'll never do it. And many times pride enters into our life and we forget that Satan knows what he's doing. Satan is a wily, evil, cunning, crafty adversary who knows how to attack each and every one of us. And we better be on guard and not let down that guard. You know, if Peter, and we don't know because this didn't happen, but what if Peter had heeded his master's warning? And Jesus says, you're going to deny me three times. He says, Lord, I don't want to do that. And he humbled himself instead of lifting himself up with pride. Would the outcome have been different when he was there and he was asked, "Surely you're one of them? Aren't you with Jesus?" We'll never know, because he lifted himself up with pride and had that haughty attitude. "I'll never forsake you." But he did. When we lift up ourselves with pride, God will stand against us. It's only those who will humble themselves under God's mighty hand that he will exalt. Question is now, have you humbled yourself under the mighty hand of God? Have you abased yourself to him to do what he says within your life? Realizing, yes, our enemy, Satan, is crafty, he's cunning, he's trying his very best to destroy us. Jesus prayed for Peter that his faith fail not. And he was converted from this time, became someone who was a Peter, a rock. Someone who is strong within the Lord's church. Why? Because he humbled himself after this. He went out and wept bitterly over what he had done. He mourned over his sin. And he repented and did what God wanted him to do. When we sin, and we succumb to those temptations of Satan, we have the same opportunity that Peter had. That we can mourn over sin. And we can repent. And we can come back and follow him. And do what he wants us to do. Be what he wants us to be. If you've never become a Christian, then why not this evening humble yourself under his hand and obey his will? If you've become a Christian, but you haven't lived the way that God wants you to live, you haven't continued to humble yourself under his will, under his desire, then why not return unto him this evening and humble yourself under God's mighty hand? That's the individual whom God will exalt. And thus we'll have that hope of an eternity with God in heaven if we will humble ourselves. If you need to do that this evening, then why not, as we stand and sing the invitation song, come and make things right with him.